So we're here with Claire Babineaux-Fontenot. She's the Chief Executive Officer of Feeding America. And you're here on the island. Basically, you're going to be meeting with the people from the Food Bank of Puerto Rico, right?
Yes, that's right.
So I guess with that in mind, why don't we talk a little bit about the situation in Puerto Rico in terms of food security and everything that's been happening. I mean, as the head of the Feeding America Network, you've probably seen the spectrum of hunger and poverty across the United States, right? So what about Puerto Rico? You know, have you been able to assess the problem on the island? And if so, what do you suggest should be done to eradicate hunger in Puerto Rico?
Yes. So, like every place that we serve, we have found a regrettable situation here in Puerto Rico as well. There are a significant number of members of the population here who struggle with poverty and with food insecurity. In fact, my information would suggest that that number on the island, though it's based upon the most recent census, so it's a little bit dated, but that number on the island is as much as 37% of the overall population here on the island is struggling with food insecurity. And when I say food insecurity, I mean that these are people who do not have consistent, predictable access to nutritious food. We know that food is fundamental to everything, and therefore without that basic necessity, people definitely would suffer.
And then when you compare that 37% to perhaps the poorest jurisdictions on the mainland, how does that, you know, compare?
Well, unfortunately, there are certain counties in the United States that would have numbers that are awfully consistent with that. But the overall number on the mainland would not be quite as high a percentage. So overall, in the United States, we have about 37 million people out of the overall population who suffer with food insecurity. So that number as a percentage of the overall population is a little lower than that percentage that we would have here on the island. But again, there are some counties and parishes like in the Mississippi Delta. There are parts of rural America that are really struggling with food insecurity as well.
Now, up north, do they have different access to perhaps finding that food security quicker or better than here in Puerto Rico?
Yeah, well, there are some natural barriers to access here on the island. The fact that it is in fact an island means if we're going to try to get resources here, it can be more challenging. It can cost more money to get those resources here onto the island. That's certainly true. But again, that's one of the things that people don't understand about food insecurity on the mainland is that there are remote areas in the United States mainland that are very difficult to access as well. So we have some data points in both places about challenges with getting food to people who live in the most remote areas here and on the mainland as well.
Now, you know, the condition here has probably gotten worse after the back-to-back hurricanes of 2017 and the most recent string of earthquakes and aftershocks. And the local food bank has been very active in delivering food to people. Have you been able to sit down with the local food bank people to see what they need? Is it money? Is it supplies? And how, you know, can Feeding America continue to help?
Yes. So first, let me compliment the local food bank. This island is fortunate to have remarkable leaders in that food bank. From the CEO to the other members of the executive team, to the board of directors, to the donors, to the volunteers. It's remarkable what that food bank has gotten done, how dedicated and focused on being of service to the members of the community the food bank is. So first and foremost, I want to say, just as the people of Puerto Rico are resilient and determined, so are the leaders inside of the local food bank determined and very focused on being of service. Then to speak to your question about those things that might be needed, the good news about having such highly principled, dedicated people is that you can feel good about sharing your resources. And of course, the resource that's easiest to translate into value would be funds. So I would encourage people to share funds, to donate funds. I would also encourage them to reach out to the food bank and ask about other resources that might be necessary. We know that during periods of disaster, for instance, that there are certain shelf-stable items that are uniquely important during those times because you can hold on to them and prepare yourself for the inevitable next event. So I know that this food bank is focused not just on addressing immediate needs, but also on being very forward-looking and thinking about how to get ready for the next event that's about to happen. So I would say those are two things. And then another thing I would encourage your listeners and viewers to contemplate is that they get an opportunity to also volunteer. So, and this, one of the things that I love about this island is the remarkable generosity in the face of so many challenges and hurdles that this island faces and the people of this island face. That in spite of that, this resiliency and this generosity of spirit, I would encourage, as you're trying to think about ways to be helpful, that you go to your food bank, your local food bank, and ask them how they might be able to use your services.
And how can nonprofits and the private sector and even the government pitch in, you know, to do their part for the food bank?
Yes. So I'm so pleased that you would ask that question. One of the things that I've noticed in my tenure in this role as CEO of Feeding America, and it's been roughly 2 years, is that there's room for everyone at the table. And what I've found to be a challenge is that people tend to want to carve out their own little tiny tables instead of coming to a big table where we all come together. And I would strongly encourage individual members of the public, members of the government, members of other nonprofits. You all want, and we all collectively want, the exact same thing. We want to be helpful for the people, to the people of our communities here. I encourage that you all come together, and a great place for convening would be with your local food bank. That you convene with the food bank, and that you think about how do you use each of these resources in concert, because you will require fewer resources, in fact, when you put them all together working for the same purpose. So I know that we've done that around the United States for quite a while, and the most impactful initiatives that we've ever had have been initiatives that have included other nonprofits, the public, government, private funders as well. I know that that's true here, and that your local CEO can speak to those kinds of things, those interactions and engagements that have happened. And I would encourage that we continue along those lines of doing things like that. So absolutely, so happy that you asked the question. There are definitely ways to be helpful and to come together.
Now let's talk about money.
Yes.
How much does Feeding America have? How much does it assign to Puerto Rico, if that's the way it works? And if not, would you happen to have an idea of how much money the local food bank needs to address that 37%? Of the population that lives with food insecurity?
Yes, so Feeding America as a national organization certainly does have donor dollars that come in. And we also, so we have the national organization, Feeding America National Office, and then there are 200 food banks around the United States. There are 60,000 pantries and agency partners, and then 2 million volunteers, so a vast network. What we've already done is engaged that network to try to be helpful here in Puerto Rico. So we've provided funding, we've provided other types of resources as well, and we've also tried to provide know-how. We have quite a bit of experience in disaster relief. Unfortunately, the people on the island have had quite a bit of experience with disasters. So we've tried to be very helpful in that regard. It's difficult to quantify how much would be needed, but I can tell you that I would encourage people to give as much as they can. Because not only do we want to solve for today, as I mentioned before, we want to be proactive and think about what are the systemic barriers that are underlying what's happening here on the island. One of the things that's really important to me about our movement is we like to use this terminology that there's this terminology around feeding the line, right? which is basic, important, fundamental, that there are people hungry today, and we have a responsibility to give people who are hungry today access to a nutritious mix of food. And there's another concept, which is shortening the line. We don't want to perpetuate a situation where people need to rely upon the charitable food system in order to be able to support their families. Most of the people who rely upon organizations like ours are hardworking, dedicated families with people who are working and who just can't make ends meet. We want people to be able to have rich, robust futures for themselves and for their children and for their grandchildren that don't rely upon these resources. So that's why I'll go back to the idea of, it's really difficult to quantify exactly how much. What I would say instead is this: out there, you know what it is that you need in order to sustain your own families, in order to sustain your own businesses. You know this. You also know where you have discretion. Well, I've had people say, you're talking about hunger, I'm more focused on education. Well, to them I say, if you're focused on education, then you absolutely need to be focused on hunger. We have data, confirmation across the board that, as an example, if a child does not get consistent access to nutritious food in the first 1,000 days of life, that there are issues that the child is likely to confront that cannot be reversed. If you care about education at any phase of life, you should care about hunger. I've had other people tell me, no, my issue is around, let's say, medical outcomes and health. All of the most insidious diseases, the chronic diseases that plague our society here on the island and across the mainland, every one of them, the best recipe for them is consistent access to nutritious food. Food, healthy food, changes medical outcomes. So whatever it is that you feel you're passionate about, I suggest to you that you should also share our collective passion for hunger. Because if you want to address whatever that issue is at the most fundamental level, you're going to need to address poverty and you're going to need to address hunger too.